Yeah, recording is starting. Now I'm going to screen share. Share sound. Share. All right. Yeah, I hope you can see the screen. Chapter 7. All right. Chapter 7 is basically explaining about how to deliver the online customer experience. In previous chapters, we have learned quite many things, such as the importance of digital marketing, how to make like short campaigns, the importance of customer relationship management, and also many others related topic on digital marketing. But on this chapter, we will focus on experience, yeah, customer experience, and how to deliver the effective medias, yeah, digital marketing campaigns, especially to make good customer experience. Because nowadays, if you have heard about UI UX, yeah, user user experience, yeah, user interface and user experience, you know, it's kind of like the very popular topic nowadays, yeah, because customers want, of course, we as a customers want to have a good experience, yeah, with the business, yeah, and also with the, yeah, anything like the campaigns or promotions, yeah, that are going, that they are conducted by the business, yeah. Of course, they want to have a success, yeah, with the campaigns that they are doing, and one of which the indicator to have, one of the indicators to determine whether the campaign or promotion is successful or not is how good they can deliver the customer experience. Yeah. And based on that, if they have, if the customers have, is having good experience, the customers can be more satisfied. And if they are satisfied, they can buy more products, and it can enhance the brand loyalty. And afterwards, of course, the customers can do the sharing, yeah, brand advocacy. Yeah, they can tell others about their experience, and of course, it will make some useful or good advantage for the business. All right, that's a little bit introduction about the customer experience. Now moving on to the next slide, the digital customer experience. So what is it? What exactly is the digital customer experience? So apparently, digital customer experience, it includes the brand's presence. Yeah, we are talking about the brand right now. Yeah, and it is imperative for the companies to make their brand's presence in anywhere, yeah, whether online or offline. Since we are talking about digital marketing, of course, it is very important for the companies to have a good brand presence on online platforms, in any different platforms, any medias, yeah, either in social medias, on social medias, on the Google search engine, or other like affiliates and other kind of medias. So what's the purpose of the brand's presence? Yeah, it's very logical, since the company has to be known, yeah, the brand especially has to be known by the customers. If they don't have good brand's presence, how can the customers know whether the brand's or the company is existed, right? So it is very important, yeah, to have a good brand's presence in the digital world. And what is the brand? The brand, yeah. The quality of the brand is based on the combination of rational and emotional factors and trauma experience. So as we can see, I highlighted the text here, the red one. So if we are talking about the brand, there are at least three components. Yeah, the rational factors. Rational factors is about whether the brand is useful for us, yeah, whether we need the product. So anything like the function, yeah, anything related to the function of the brand itself. And it can be taught, yeah. I mean, we can think about it, yeah, whether it is useful. That is the rational part. And the second of all, the second thing is about the emotional. Now, this is also very important for the brand. And I think probably the emotional factors can be more important than rational factors. Yeah. Like the luxury brand, you know, LV, Gucci, like in terms of function, it's just the same. It's a clothing. It's like bags, you know, expensive bags like Hermes, something. Yeah. But in terms of rational, is the function is just the bag like or the clothing, right? But there's emotional factors on that, right? The especially for the luxury brand, we feel that if we are using or wearing the luxury brands, our self-esteem can be increased. Yeah, we can feel, oh, we are more our level, right? The wealth level is higher than others. Yeah, for proving that we are more successful than others. That's the emotional factors. Yeah, and usually it is one of the important components in the luxury brand. Yeah, and the third thing is the promise experience, and you know, a lot of companies, they are trying their best to provide good customer experience. For example, we can access their website, you know, the like Nike website or Apple website. Yeah, we can see from their website. We may not think that far. Yeah, we shouldn't think too much. Yeah. We can see about their efforts that they exerted to create a good website. That's also the experience. And if the customers bought some products, for example, the unboxing of the products, you know, the products came with the box, and we have, if the box is very exquisite or it's the box is very fancy or it's unique, it consists of like a art or something like that, it can be a good customer experience as well. Yeah, that's why packaging is also one of the important factors, right? If you are buying the product, even though it's kind of like a secondary things, but still, yeah, for instance, the Apple, their packaging is very good. It's simple yet it's aesthetic, and a lot of people kind of like it, and it can be like a unique experiences, yeah, for the customers. Yeah. Even in the on the YouTube channel, we can see some of the channels, you know, the Unbox Therapy. If you like to watch the reviews, yeah, technology reviews, they focus on the unboxing, and the channels, the subscribers of that channel is like millions. So it proves that people like to have like a good unboxing experience. Yeah, they kind of curious to see. Oh, so this box is very unique. So people. Yeah, it's a part of the experience. Yeah. Yeah, not only the marketing itself. Yeah, the company can also make gaming, you know, the game advertising, but combined with the gamification, it also can, they can also provide some experiences to the customers. Yeah. So if you are talking about the experience, a lot of things can be done by the company. And the purpose of the brand's presence, as we can see from the slide, The main purpose is to influence customers' perceptions. So what? So the customers would have good and positive attitude towards the brand. And we can use pictures. Yeah, it is proven that using pictures, it can provide strong visual. So that's why we are asking you to make the pictures, yeah, to entice the prospective customers, in that case, the high school students, yeah, to make them aware and also interested to study at IBE. Yeah. So you have to provide a strong visual pictures, yeah, or maybe logos or anything related that you can put in your graphics, yeah, signs or whatever, the photos, yeah, and hopefully it can attract the customers. And the second thing is interactive. Yeah, pictures, if we use the social media, there are comments, right? There are comments column, which the customers can make a comment. They can be very interactive. Yeah? When you post on Instagram, when you post the picture, the advertising photos on the Facebook, it can be interactive when you post it on the social medias. YouTube is also the same. Yeah, even that's more interactive. Not interactive. I mean, it is richer because it is videos. I think videos is better than pictures to some extent. Yeah, since if we are using videos, of course, we can see the pictures moving. Yeah, and also there is the sound. It's more alive. Yeah, it's more realistic, and that's why nowadays, at least a few years, these recent years, as we can see from the TikTok, the trend of the social media, TikTok is one of the social media that is widely used, yeah, not only in the world but also in Indonesia as well, and that's the short videos. On Instagram, we have the reels. Yeah, YouTube, we have the YouTube shorts, and that's the trend nowadays. Yeah, video seems to have more higher degree of attractiveness compared to pictures. As for myself, I like to watch the short videos more compared to just watch the pictures, like or IG feed or maybe the YouTube, Facebook posts. It's kind of like more, lebih dapat gitu ya. That's right. It's hard to express it in English. And kind of sometimes I can be addictive too, right? To watch the short videos like reels and or YouTube shorts. I kind of like forgot the time and then in the end I just spend like 1 hour, 2 hours just watch those short videos. That's what happened nowadays. So using pictures and now videos, and to make the brand's presence more successful, we can integrate the multiple channels. So it's the same like this, on different platforms. So different platforms is not just a mere different platforms, but we have to integrate those platforms, like we are using the consistent pictures or consistent colors at least. So we can see the integration between the medias. That's for the digital customer experience. I provide two videos with regard to digital customer experience, which we can watch together. All right. Let me click first.
Everyone loves spreadsheets. Actually, they don't. But check this out. Okay, Monday.com, get started.
Okay, could you hear the sound of the video? You can, right?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. Let's watch together.
Companies that get the customer experience right will win in the marketplace. But that requires bringing digital, physical, and mobile experiences together, including the data and the systems that support them. If you truly understand how to use that data, you can transform your customers' experience in new and exciting ways they've never imagined. This is Carol. She's the marketing manager for Altiva Air Conditioning and is about to launch a new marketing campaign. By analyzing multiple information channels, she learns a very long hot summer is forecast and plans the next marketing campaign. Meet Jack and Yu Chen. They're looking to buy a home air conditioning system. Jack's been researching brands and local retailers to get the best deal. This is Steve. He's trying to understand more about Jack and Yu Chen's needs. Steve views Jack's customer profile, which has been enhanced with location, demographic, and social data, such as Twitter and Facebook and other information feeds, to get a complete picture of their requirements. Using this information, Steve can create a custom offering of AC system installation and maintenance package. Steve's been able to go that extra mile to give Jack and Yu Chen a personalized customer experience. This is Sharitha, the Director of Customer Service at Altiva. She manages the customer service call center and their network of commercial air conditioning contractors. Through her CRM dashboard, she can see marketing campaign alerts from Carol and ensures she'll have enough skilled resources to cope with the expected spike in sales. The call center teams are notified about the pending influx of customers and see the campaign information is integrated into their contact center system. Sharitha adds additional service offers to the campaign, which might be of interest to customers, to allow cross-sell and upsell opportunities. With digital marketing automation, social listening, and CRM integration, she can view her dashboard with all the data and customer service-related information, such as call volumes, response times, and complaints. She can now activate response plans and draw on additional resources, including the partner channels. Let Avanade help you to transform your customer experience by driving insight from all of your data.
Yeah, so if you can see from the videos, there are three components. There are the CRM integration, yeah, and social listening, and there is another one. Digital marketing automation. So these three components we can integrate and we can use it. Yeah. We can use this to enrich the personalized customer experience. Why social listening? Because we can know more about our customers. When the customer posted information on their social media, whether their hobbies, their personal life, pictures, videos. This can be a useful tool for the marketers to know better about their customers. Yeah, it can be kind of like privacy issues, but you know, like if you're on social media, everything you put on the social media, it means that you're already aware that will be consumed by the public, right? Even though if we activate our privacy settings, but who will know for sure whether the data that we put on the internet, on the social media, or in particular, will be kept secure? That's the problem, you know. Just assume, for me, for myself, I just assume that if we dare to put our anything, our story, our feed, our pictures, videos or whatever. If you already put it on the internet, whether on social medias, your website, it means you are ready to be, I mean the data, there's a risk. Yeah, there is a risk about the data can be stolen or can be used for different purposes. Regardless our how good your security, but I think we have to be very careful, especially if we are using the social media. You already learned about the social dilemma, right? The movies on the UTS. Yeah, and if you watch the movie carefully, I think it was very scary. Yeah, how the company use our data, and we are our product, and we are the products of their company. Yeah, and nothing is free actually. We use Facebook, we use Instagram, that seems for free, but you know, in the end, yeah, we are the product. Because they use our data for their own goods, yeah, for their own sake, for advertisings. And if you don't really care about our privacy, that's okay. I think everyone has different preferences about the privacy. But for me, I'm quite aware, I'm quite care about the privacy. So I kind of care so much about the privacy settings, even though I don't trust it 100%, but it is I think a lot better to use it than not using it. Yeah, I think that's my opinion about the social listening. It's kind of the good for the company, but for the customers, yeah, we can be I think we have to be very careful about that. Digital marketing automation, yeah, it's very useful for the digital marketers, since we don't need to do it manually. Everything can be more automated. It can save more time, save energy. And but the bad thing is about automation, it reduces the human power, and like robots. Yeah. We use robots quite a lot. And it can replace the humans in some working fields, like, you know, teller in the bank, teller di bank. It has begun to be replaced by the e-banking and customer service. It is being replaced by the chatbot, using the AI technology. Yeah, it is quite scary. There's some drastic changes on the working place environment. Yeah, since there are many automation and a lot of jobs are being replaced by the use of new technologies. So yeah, that's I think all of you are very lucky. Yeah, to study IBE, International Business Engineering. You know how, I assume that you know how to make the system, yeah, and to create automation system. You are in control of that. Yeah, you don't need to be afraid about being replaced by robots or the new technologies. Yeah, I think you are very, very lucky on that. So in the future, when you are looking for a job, then you can focus more on the, yeah, you know, the automation, the business process automation, right? If you're working on the operational or in the manufacturing, in the factories, you can focus on that. Yeah, you are the one who may program the robots, you know, and the salary can be quite high, yeah, as compared to the people who operate the robots. Yeah. Anyway, yeah, that's my thoughts about this automation. Okay, we shall continue on the next video. Oh, before I'm moving on to the next video, is there any comments or any questions that you wanna ask? Yeah, sorry. I like to talk quite a lot about this matter, yeah, because I think it is a good opportunity to share with you about my own opinions about these issues. Yeah. Okay. Anyone? Okay, maybe not yet. Yeah, we continue first. Yeah. Okay, next one. This one, I like this a lot. Yeah, I like this a lot. It's very creative way to create customer experience. So if you haven't seen this, I think you should probably see this, and who knows, you can copy this to your business. The first time I saw this commercial, so this is actually the Switzerland tourism, the Graubünden, I think that's a village in the Switzerland. Yeah, I kind of very interested in this, how they create the marketing campaign like that. So they put the like some kind of kiosk with the real-time videos camera on it, and they ask the people who are passing by, and yeah, that's I think that's a very creative and very interactive ways to develop the customer experience. If I were on that scene, I think surprised. Yeah. That's one of many ways to nurture the customer experience. Some kind of I think this one is very unique, very interactive, as well as surprising. Yeah, It's, they can print the ticket right away for free to for the people who like to go to that to Graubünden. I kind of like speechless when I was when I first time saw this advertising. How can be this so creative? All right, that's one of the many examples that I want to show to you. You can be very creative, yeah, to enhance the customer experience. So the idea is to make the customer has the long-lasting experience, a long-lasting feeling, yeah, about your campaign. Whatever medias that you use, either combine like in this Switzerland tourism video or marketing. So it combine, it is combined with the digital as well as the on-site, yeah, because they put the kiosk on the train station, right? So it's combined, it is combining two medias, not two medias, yeah, two components, yeah, the online as also the offline. That's the very brilliant, I guess. Yeah. Right, we are moving on to the next slide. How to create effective digital experience. Before we deal with the OA, we have to know about what effective really means. So effective means there are three things. It is relevance, it is satisfactory, it can make the users satisfied. And this is also very important, yeah, it support and add value to the brand. Yeah. So we are taking the example of the Switzerland tourism video that we just watched a few minutes ago. Is it relevance? I think it's very relevant. Was the customer satisfied? From the face, I could see that the customers are really had a higher satisfaction about the campaign. Was it support and adding the value to the brand? Yeah, I guess it's also supporting and adding value to the brand. Yeah, because people would know about the Graubünden, about the there's a small village, a very beautiful village nearby the city, which you can reach there to have a very short holiday. And I think people would know about the brand and it can add the value to the brand. So these are the three things that we really have to consider if we want to create the effective digital experience to the customers. Second of all, we can use so-called the CRO, or conversion rate optimization. We can see the key goals here. What is the CRO? It relates to the sales, yeah, number of sales. If we are dealing with the tourism, like the tourism place or airline tickets, or bus tickets, train tickets, is how many booking that you have. And you can also measure the leads, yeah, whether the customers are interested in the product or service. By using CRO, we can improve the commercial contribution of online presence to a business. Since this is related to conversion, of course, we are dealing with the financial part of the which is I think the most important part too, right? Commercial contribution, but we call it as a commercial contribution. That is the ultimate goal of the digital marketing, actually, yeah, to having a good or high conversion rate. Because in the end, you have to have profits, you have to have a good number of sales. If you are doing your best to create digital marketing campaigns, a very successful quote unquote successful promotion, but nobody use or nobody buy the product or service, or only a small percent of people who like the product, but they are not going to buy it by the product or service, then I think we can definitely say the digital marketing efforts that we spend for the promotion or digital marketing is in vain, or in other words, is not that useful. Yeah, since the conversion is not achieved, hasn't been achieved. We see the formula from the previous chapters. We can notice that the conversion is very important, and it is usually put at the end of the digital marketing formula, since that's the ultimate goal of why we are doing marketing, to increase the sales. That's why the CRO, the digital marketers, or anyone who are dealing with the marketing works, they really have to take very careful attention to the conversion rate and make it more optimized. Make it the CRO more optimized. What it means if it is more optimized? It means that when you having high digital marketing efforts, if the conversion rate optimization is high, then you will have higher people who are willing, not who are willing, who are buying the products, who are buying the service. So the rate is, the relationship is positive. The higher digital marketing efforts or money that you spend, the higher rate of the customers who buy your products or service. It can be even better if the conversion rate is optimization is higher. So the small increase of the digital marketing efforts, it can lead to the or slight increase, the slight increase of the digital marketing that we have performed, it can result into higher increase of the conversion. That's what we really want, actually, but that's very hard. So that's why we really have to carefully plan our strategy in doing digital marketing. We have to make the seamless integration between the media. So all sort of things that we have discussed earlier, it has to be done not perfectly, but need to be better to make this conversion rate more optimized. I think that's the main idea. So this one, on figure 7.2, this is also very important figures, which describe or depicts the success factors of online customer experience. As you can see, there are a lot of factors. From the products is the four, like the four P's, the price, promotions, the range of products, degree of interactivity, like the Graubünden commercial that we just watched. I think it had a very high degree of interactivity, because there are two ways interaction, two ways communication between the advertisers with the people who are passing by on the train station. Service is related to the whether, for example, when we buy something, then how we can receive the products or service. The fulfillment, the goods, how can the goods can be distributed, for how long, who are the couriers or the expedition service, something like that. That's a issue of fulfillment. And also the support is related to the customer service. If we are receiving the goods or the products that we just bought, if there is any defects, yeah, if there are any defects, how can we do a complaint? That's a support. Yeah. Or we have a problem with the payment. Yeah, sometimes we have the problems, yeah, is the credit card already charged, but the products on the website, it is not, the purchase is not successful, but the credit card is being charged. That's the problem. Yeah. So we need to call the support to finish to have the solution of that problem. The design, visual design, the style tone, reassurance is talking about the trust to the company, to the brand, to the products or services. Credibility is also related with the company, whether the company is credible or not. Ease of use, whether we can use the website or the e-commerce easily. Relevance, performance, it's this kind of factors, which can influence the success of making customers having a good experience about our company, about our brand, about our product or services. And it is divided into three, as we mentioned on the first slide. Yeah, there are three things: the rational values, emotional values, and also the promise experience. Now we are discussing a little bit about the website design. Now I want to ask you whether you are learned or you have the mata kuliah, a course about how to develop a website. Is there any have you learned about website design on the university?
Again, it's my voice. Can you hear my voice?
Yeah, I can hear Stefano. Thank you.
Okay. So I think in IBE we have it wasn't a class for a class special for focused on this website design, but it's part of it. It's basically our business analytics or business intelligence class. So the lecturer, he encouraged us to design and how to create a simple website to promote our password. Something like that. But we don't have a class especially focused on
designing website. That's okay. You can always learn by yourself. A lot of tutorials on YouTube which you can watch, how to design a website, and of course there are many tools to assist you in designing the website. As to my knowledge, nowadays you are trying to designing a website. Of course, we have to know a little bit about HTML, and if we are trying to build a dynamic website, which there are some kind of programming in the on the website, storing the information, you have the access user access roles, you have the login functions. Of course you have to study the PHP and also the DBMS, database management system, or you can use MySQL or MongoDB or others database DBMS, or if the scale is very big, like the for the corporate, you can use the Oracle or DB2, IBM DB2. A lot of things. If you are interested in designing website, and also for those who like to do the programming, coding, you can learn a lot of things. And the source are you can just simply, it is so easy to find the tutorials on Google, on the internet. And it can be learned. Yeah, it can be learned. In digital marketing, we emphasize. Yeah, we really emphasize about the importance to have good company website. I think this is a must. Yeah, for every company, whether it's small, it is medium. Yeah, and also the big company, yeah, they should have a good company website. Why? Because when people don't know about your company, yeah, they don't know anything about your company, I think the first thing that they are doing is searching your company on Google. If you can provide the website, which is very, you know, artistic, well-designed, as well as having a good performance, thereby offering the customers experience when accessing your website, that's a good value. That is a value-added things, yeah? A value-added service to the customers, which can, of course, influence their positive attitude toward the company, and in which can influence their customer experience as well. Yeah. So is the question is whether digital marketer needs to design a website too? Is it still on their main jobs? Yeah. Oh, maybe not. Yeah, because digital marketers has their own works to do, and it's a lot of works already. So how are we going to design a website then? Yeah, we can just simply hire somebody. Yeah, maybe we can call it a software house or a consultant, as we may say, to design the website for the company. Yeah. And it needs to be noted that designing a good website, it costs money. Yeah, we cannot just for the company who doesn't know about the website design at all and how much the fees or salary, you call it, right? The money, yeah, spent to make a website design, or they may be surprised about the price. Yeah, for those who doesn't know anything about the website design, yeah, they may the company may say, okay, I will have a budget of 10 million rupiah to make a good website. Yeah, please go ahead. You can search the professional, the consultant, a website design consultant. I think nobody wants to do that project, yeah, unless they are really, really need the money. As to my knowledge, if the company really want a good website design, this is dynamic with the high system quality, also the good service quality. So everything is well designed. Then the company may spend at least 50 to hundreds of millions of rupiah. Yeah, because a friend of mine is a professional, a website designer, and he said that his starting point, you know, the very first numbers that if he really wants to do a project, the lowest number that he can go is like 50 million, 50 million, 50 juta. Yeah, lower than that, he doesn't want to do that project. Yeah, because It's wasting time, he said. Yeah. And this friend of mine is also had work on several different type of projects. One of which in recently he also worked for Mitsubishi Ion Mall, yeah, designing their website and also the building information systems. Yeah, so that's maybe different level. Yeah, a different level. But for if you want to have the cheap, you know, affordable website designer, probably a company can hire the students. You know, students who are doing internship. I think that's one choice. Yeah, one option that the company can think of. Yeah, can consider about it. But of course, the results may be not comparable to those who are very professional on their job or their works. Yeah, that's just for your information. Yeah, if your family or if your friends, yeah, who want to hire consultant or freelancer to make to create or to develop the website, please notice about the fees. Yeah, you cannot. It is quite hard to hire someone, yeah, who are willing to make a website design with a very low fee, yeah, especially nowadays. Of course, if you pay more, you can have more higher quality, yeah, because money talks. Yeah. Money talks, and it is it happens. Okay, anyway, yeah, that's just my suggestions, yeah, for all of you who wants to make a good website design. There are many ways. I already told you to, if you are, don't have time to create your website by your own, you can hire somebody, hire a consultant, hire an IT or software consultant company. But of course, you have to spend quite a lot of money. But otherwise, you can study by yourself. But it needs time. Unless you already have the basic of the programming, yeah, it can save more time. But I think for designing website or any kind of a programming related works, it needs not only skills but also experience. Yeah, I think many things need to have experience, right? Like driving, swimming. Yeah, the better we have you know, jam terbangnya gitu ya, jam terbangnya lebih banyak. Yeah, of course we can do better. All right. Yeah, this is the summary of the process of website development. Yeah, it's a long process. Yeah, it's we in information systems field, we call it as the SDLC, yeah, System Development Lifecycle. It starts with the marketing objectives until the launching of the site. Yeah, on the right side, yeah, sorry, the left side is the main site development activities. So this is the main functions, and the right side is the key supporting activities. And this, I think, should be done by the team. Yeah, it can be done by one people, but this one people needs to work a lot. Usually it's a team, yeah, for designing website or for making a program, yeah, in IT. It's usually it is done by a team of programmer. It's very rare to have one people only to finish a project, especially if the project is very big. I think usually it can consist, the team itself, it can consist of like more than 50 or maybe 100, if not like hundreds of people who work on the project. So who should be involved in a website project? A lot of people: sponsors, senior managers, the owner. Yeah, because if we are there are many methods, yeah, to develop the information systems, in this case the website. Yeah, we can have, if you have ever heard the Scrum methodology, agile methodology. We also have the waterfall. We have the prototyping, especially for the prototyping methods. The involvement of the owners, the users, is very important, yeah, because it's an iterative process, which the inputs of the owners about the development of their website is very, very crucial. Yeah. Since the owners is being involved quite a lot, then I think the projects can be the success rate of the projects can be increased. Yeah, because the owners know what he or she really wants about the website. Yeah. And since they are working closely together with the developers teams, then the expectation of the owners of the users, yeah, can be at least the same. Yeah, it can be similar to the what the developers are being built. So it can reduce the risk, yeah, of disagreement between the owners and also the with the developers. So that's why we have to involve the owner. The project manager, yeah, is the one who lead the project, manage the project, site designer, content developer, because the website needs to be filled with the copywriting. This is the role of content developer. The webmasters, digital experience analysis, yeah, sorry, this is analysis and CRO expert. This is where the digital marketers come in, and also the stakeholders, so anyone related with the project. Yeah, for example, the employees who are going to be the webmaster, you know, or the suppliers, or anyone, yeah, who are involved in this project. That's the stakeholders. Outsourcing, yeah, we can do two things if we decide to outsource the website project. Outside in or inside out, usually outside in. Yeah, I think it's more people like to do outside in more than inside out. So what it means about outside in, yeah, it basically starts with the digital marketing technologies. We outsource the digital marketing activities, yeah, and we bring their expertise into our company. Yeah, since we don't have enough people, or we can call it an insufficient in-house expertise, so we have to rely on other people. That's outside in. No choice, because we don't have any expertise in our company, so we have to outsource outside. Inside out, this is very, I think it's quite rare, inside out, but I think a few companies are doing this. They are starts to implement digital marketing using existing resources. So it begins with the internal expertise first, and they also doing recruitment of digital media specialists. So they are doing both. Yeah. So their internal people, they are doing digital marketing in conjunction or together with the digital media specialist, which they are outsourced. That's what we call as inside out. This is kind of like the name of the movie, Inside Out. Prototyping software development. Yeah, I already mentioned this. Yeah, prototyping is, we can see it's a primary preliminary version of part of our framework of our website, can be reviewed by its target audience. So that's why I repeatedly mentioned that the importance of owners, yeah, because the owners is the target audience. Yeah. Also, if we are developing the digital marketing tools or digital marketing website, then we need to involve the marketing team as well, because they are the one who maybe operate the website later on after the website is finished built. Yeah, it's finished being built. And iteration of the prototype, yeah, begins with discovery, analysis, design, develop, test, and review. Yeah, this is agile software development. I think this is just a supplementary materials which you can read by yourself. So basically, it's methods of software development. Yeah. I already mentioned there are many types of methods of software development. One of which is the agile. Yeah, and the methods that is usually or widely used, we call it Scrum. Yeah, this is one example. Yeah, this is a very popular method to develop the information system or website. Website project, yeah, we begin with the initiation, domain name selection. Yeah. Each has different costs. .com, .co.id, Indonesia, yeah, .ac.id, AC is academic, yeah, or edu, yeah, is .edu, and .edu usually is academic, but in the US, normally, yeah, but some university is able to, in Indonesia, yeah, some university in Indonesia, including UPH, is able to get edu domain, yeah, because it was purchased or bought a long time ago, so there was still available, but nowadays it's very hard to have the EDU for Indonesian institution, ORG organization, and so on and so forth. So after that, we need to concern about the name of our website, the link, yeah, the address or URL address. So just in case you don't know about the abbreviation of URLs, is Uniform Resource Locators. And the last one that this is also very important, the hosting provider. There are many providers who can provide the website hosting. Yeah, in Indonesia itself, we have several big companies, Dewa Web. Yeah, there are many others, Biznet, you know, the hosting providers. Yeah, we have to select the hosting providers carefully. Yeah. Otherwise, if we don't choose the reliable hosting provider, it can affect our business too, right? Our website can be down more often, or there are many technical issues, and we don't want that, do we? Yeah. User-centered design, business requirements, yeah, usability requirements, yeah, a lot of things that we need to define, yeah, during the requirements process. Okay. I think due to time, I need to hurry up, yeah, to wrap this chapter. Localization, yeah, localization. Localization is basically the company who operate in a global market. So, for example, McDonald's. Yeah, if we access the McDonald's website in Indonesia, is gonna be different. I think it's different. You can check by yourself. Different than the McDonald's website in the US or in the Europe or in Singapore. Yeah, that's if they are doing that, it is called the localization. Yeah. It's also the same with the foods. Yeah, with the McDonald's foods in Indonesia, you have the chicken and rice, but in the Singapore, no rice. Yeah, you can check whether McDonald's in Singapore, whether they are selling rice or not, and also chicken. Yeah, I think they don't sell any rice. A few years ago, I went to Singapore and because I was kind of confused what to eat. I just went to McDonald's and wanna eat the rice, but I couldn't find any rice on McDonald's. But in Indonesia, it's very common. McDonald's, they are selling fried KFC menus, right? The rice with the fried chicken and with the sambal, yeah, the spicy something. Yeah, they keep innovating, yeah, by following the culture on the place that they are doing business in. This is McDonald's.co.id. Maybe now it's different. I took this screenshot a few years ago. Yeah, the idea is just different because in the US, they have different cultures than in Indonesia. Yeah, in Indonesia, probably people, kids, yeah, kids, children, they like to go to McDonald's. Maybe that's why they put these toys in front of the page. Yeah. So there are different customers' characteristics. So they have to adjust. Yeah, and they have then those big companies, they can do localization. Yeah, it usually it's usually being done by the global companies like McDonald's. One way to measure how good our website is to review competitor website, yeah, benchmarking. Yeah, we call it as benchmarking. We compare our performance, not only performance, anything, yeah, starting from financial performance, conversion efficiency, marketplace, and so on and so forth. Yeah, we compare these indicators with other website. Yeah, we call this in Indonesia, we call it a studi banding, comparison study. Yeah, comparison study. It's always a good idea to compare ourselves with our competitors. Yeah, so that we know where we are and how are we going to compete with the competitors. Yeah, don't be kalau pepatah bilang don't be apa ya frogs under the tempurung what is the tempurung ya? Yeah, katak di bawah tempurung lah gitu ya. Yeah, don't be like that. Because in the business, we have to look out. Yeah, we have to do benchmarking often. Because our competitors, we have to study our competitors. Otherwise, how can we? How do we know? Yeah, how do we know the competitors are doing that? They are doing this. If we don't do benchmarking, yeah, we can be left behind. And this one is talking about the information architecture, IA. Yeah, by definition is, we can read, the combination of organization labeling navigation schemes constituting an information system. Or basically in other words, or it's simply in a simple words, is the arrangement of the information. Yeah, so that the customer or the users or anyone who read the information is going to be or having more having better understanding about the content of the information that we provided. Yeah, that's the main goal of the information architecture. Yeah, it involves the creating plan to group information logically. Yeah, if we group the information in a logical sequence, it is of course will be easier to be understood by the users. Yeah, we cannot just put any information that we want, for example with this big like this. Yeah, classification, for example, yeah, the labels and tagging, the tagging, yeah, we don't have this, then people may be confused. Yeah, we don't have any search functions on the website, then how can we, if we want to search, how can we do that? Yeah, navigation and wayfinding. The navigation of our website is a mess, and people will be probably maybe frustrated in assessing your website or making your using your website. Yeah, it can be frustrated for them. So that's why we use the knowledge, yeah, we call it as the information architecture. Yeah, it is part of the HCI, yeah, human computer interaction, or in Indonesia we call it as interaksi manusia dan komputer. Yeah, we use this, yeah, to create better information, yeah, to be provided to the people, yeah, so that they can better understand the information that we have provided. That's the main idea of the IA, information architecture. This is the example of the site structure diagram. Yeah, we can see if we have this site structure, it is easier for the users, website users, to navigate throughout your website. Now, this is the layout of the website, and we have the banner up there, you know, the navigation button, the main page, and so on and so forth. This is specialization of this UI UX, the user interface, user experience, and it's a widely researched field in the as I mentioned previously, human computer interaction. Yeah, this is UX, user experience. Yeah, it's focused on the user-centered design. Now we kind of more concerned on the simplicity. Yeah, and according to Fogg et al. 2003, the most important factors in user experience is design look. Yeah, I think this is very obvious. If we have the good design, then people may appreciate your website more than the bad design. Information design structure, focus, and so on and so forth. So what are the things to consider? We can evaluate the design, effectiveness, productivity, satisfaction, also the elements of website design, site design structure, page design, content design. So after the website is being developed, we have to do testing. We can develop and testing of content. We probably use the what we call as a CMS, content management system, like Joomla or WordPress. Yeah, if you are familiar with that, WordPress is not only for blogging, but it's also a content management system. Yeah, we can use it for content management. Yeah, we can use that for arranging or managing our content on the website. Joomla, WordPress, or Drupal. Yeah, Drupal usually is used for e-commerce related website. Testing experience. Yeah, marketing managers. It's always better. Yeah, for the anyone who are involved in the digital marketing or the marketing department. Yeah, it is a value added for them. Yeah, if they have the basic awareness of website development and testing. Yeah, at least they know. To some extent, yeah, the technical ways to develop website, yeah, it's as for me, I would say it's better than nothing. It's better than nothing. But if they don't have, it's also fine because they can always hire the people who are more knowledgeable on the website development. Yeah, service quality, it is one of the main concern on the website. Yeah, according to Para Suraman, yeah, it is a very important construct. Yeah, we know as the abbreviation of service quality is ServQual. Yeah, if you have learned this, yeah, it is one of the most important concepts in the website design. Yeah, good service quality will relate to any positive things to the customer experience. It consists of several dimensions: tangibles, reliability. The website is reliable. The website is responsive. It's rarely hang. It's rarely crashed. It can provide assurance to increase trust, empathy. A lot of dimensions. And the Para Suraman et al. 1985 is focused at that time. Back then, it was focused on the service, traditional service. Yeah, is because in 1985 there was internet back then, but it's still very limited. So it focused on the traditional service like in the restaurants, in the hotels, any service, traditional service. But because of the internet, the ServQual construct has been updated to eServQual. It was firstly proposed by Zed Ham et al. 2007, and it consists of seven dimensions: efficiency, fulfillment, reliability, privacy, reputation, compensation, and contact. This is just for your information. If you are, want to develop a website, these are the one of the most important factors that we can consider, the service quality, or this one is more important, is service quality. Okay, that's for the chapter seven. Now we only have 30 minutes left. So I think for the next chapter, I just try to emphasize on the most important points that I think it is necessary for all of you to know. So chapter 8 is about the campaign planning for digital media. Actually, you had studied this with Ibu Kalandra a few weeks ago, where she showed you how to make the campaign using the social media. There is a statement, if you build it, they will come, but is it true? I think is partly true, but not entirely true. Yeah, of course, we have to build something. We have to build website, but whether they will come for sure, that's maybe different story. Yeah, for sure we have to have the website first. Yeah, otherwise, we cannot show them anything. And to make our website is known but to others, we have to advertise our website, right? We have to do SEO, search engine optimization, so that the search result will come up in first page. Yeah, so people will click on the search engine result and people can access our website. Yeah, we have to build it at first, yeah, but we have to advertise it. We have to let people know. Yeah. So there's the statement is true, but it's not completely true because we need to add more sentence on this one. Yeah, we have to advertise it so that they will really come. We have to select appropriate online offline marketing communication, of course. Yeah, we have to planning for how digital media use. And talking about campaigns, there are two types of campaigns, short-term campaigns and long-term campaigns. Short-term campaigns is usually used for supporting particular goals. For example, when we launch a new products, Samsung was just recently launched the Galaxy S22 Ultra. Yeah, it's a short-term campaign. But long-term campaigns is quite different than the short-term campaigns because long-term campaigns, they focus more on continuous e-communication activities. Yeah, is long-term, since it is long-term, it can be 1 year, 2 years, 3 years. And the main purpose is the one that I highlighted, right? Planting the brand to the customer's mindset. It's kind of like the educational purpose. Yeah, or you can say the brainwashing, yeah, cuci otak, brainwashing or propaganda. Yeah, to make other people aware about the brand, crazy about the brand, to be extreme. Yeah, that's the long term campaign. The main purpose of the long term campaign. For example, there's a Pokhari challenge. Yeah, this is also a very interesting challenge where they target the high school students. They use the very good, very artistic animation. I can show you. Oh, cannot be click. Let's copy this. Let's select two.
Together, we are Valorant.
Otsuka.
The Pokhari Sweat.
Aku merasa baik-baik saja. Aku cinta pulau ini. Menurutku, di sini pantainya lebih bagus.
Ada banyak mall di sini.
Banyak teman.
Nilai ujianku juga lumayan sih.
Tapi itu tidak cukup.
Ah. Aku ingin terus mengejar mimpi.
Melihat dunia di luar sana.
Setiap hari memang menyenangkan.
Tapi itu tidak cukup.
Karena itu, ayo lari sekarang.
Yeah, it's a very Japanese style animation, yeah, like Studio Ghibli kind of. Yeah. If you like to watch the Japanese anime movies, there are some very famous movies like Spirited Away or a few years ago, like in 2019, there's a movie called, I forgot the name. Yeah, this is just a typical Japanese advertising that use the anime that I think they did it really well, yeah, in terms of the animation, the message that they convey to the their customers, where they targeted the high school students. That's a very appropriate ways, yeah, to do a campaign like that. Next one is JDIB. Yeah, I believe maybe some of you or maybe all of you have shopped on JDIB. So they really concerned about the originality, yeah, about their products. So they use this kind of symbols. Yeah. If they can be trusted, yeah, because the product is original. They don't sell any fake products. Yeah, that's what they are advertised. Let's see the JDIB campaign.
Janji itu butuh komitmen yang asli. Asli yang bersungguh-sungguh. Untuk peduli, untuk berbagi, dan komitmen yang asli pasti tepati janji. Seperti JDID memberi yang asli tanpa kompromi.
JDID dijamin ori.
Okay, yeah, this is also a good video, yeah, where they
English is my second language. As a
yeah, they make they portray their different stories, like the husband who are being seems that he has the selingkuhan, but he still remember he has a responsibility to his wife, so he didn't want to make his wife he still wanted to be trusted by his wife, yeah, so that's why he canceled the invitation of his girlfriend. It's kind of like a metaphors. Yeah, metaphors is they use it to convey the message that JDID can be trusted. That's also one way to increase the your emotion. I mean to touch your emotion. Yeah, they use the story. Everyday life story to touch your emotion, and they relate it to their brand, their thing that they are advertised, yeah, the focus, which is trust, yeah, the original products. Yeah, characteristic for digital media, they are push to pull, Yeah, kalau if it is push is a traditional media where like advertising on television is a push. So the company is pushing the advertising to the customers. But if it is pull, the customer itself who try to search for information. We call it as inbound marketing. That's the pull. And that's the difference between the push and the pull. From monologue to dialogue to trialogue, yeah, a lot more people involved in the interactivity, yeah, especially in social medias. You can have dialogues. Next one is one to many, one to some, one to one. Yeah, it concern about the mass customization and personalization, in which the message can be personalized, yeah, because we can use the CRM technologies to make personalization. One to many, many to many communication. Yeah, again with the social media, customers can interact with other customers. Yeah, not only social medias, online review websites. We can also do that. From lean back to lean forward. Yeah, what does it mean? Yeah, what does lean forward mean? It means the forward is the information can be controlled by customers, yeah, for the social media, for instance. If we don't want to see any, if we don't want to get involved with the certain company's brand social media, a certain company social media, we just simply don't click on that page, yeah, on the page on the Facebook, for example. It is in within our control. Yeah, and we can also experience flow. Experience flow means that we are really interested in that brand, yeah, so that we spend a lot of time in like searching the brand. Yeah, we are talking about the brand with our peers, and we spend a lot of time talking about the brand. That's what we call as experiencing flow. So in other words, for other example, like if we are playing games, yeah, if we are playing games, when we are experience flow, we are kind of like forgot the time. We played like 24 hours a day. We forgot to eat, yeah, because we are really deep, really focused on the game. Then in that state, we can call it we are experiencing flow. And the company, I think they really want to they want to make the customers experiencing flow as well. Yeah, so it means if the customers is experiencing flow, the customers can have better engagement, yeah, the closer relationship with the customer, with the company, yeah, anything related with the engagement. So this is a summary and different characteristics of the traditional media, digital media. So traditional media is focused on push, yeah, like TV, print ads, direct mails. It's a one-way communication and so on and so forth. And digital media, we can see, is basically focused on the pull emphasis. And they use, it's basically more advanced than traditional media. Yeah, it's more interactive. We can involve more people in this. The campaign is dynamic. We can change in the because there are dashboards, right? When Bukalanda showed you, there are dashboards, yeah, which you can adjust the for example, the number of the reach of the campaign, right? If you target to certain island in Indonesia like Sumatra, Sulawesi, it can be changed. Yeah, all those indicators can be changed. So that's why it's dynamic. And it's continuous, always on. It can reach globally, yeah, compared to traditional media. If you are using internet anywhere, anytime, it can be accessed. Yeah. In the world, but for traditional media, for TVs, for example, RCTI or Trans, it can only be accessed by Indonesia in when we are in Indonesia. But we can access it unless we are using the internet TV. Yeah, But normally we cannot access it outside Indonesia if we are using the normal TV, yeah, not using internet. So there's a limitation of the traditional media. And this is the comparison of the property of different media, TV, outdoor, print, this is baliho, print, internet, brochure, yeah, or print. And we can see the degree of intrusiveness, yeah, gangguannya. So TV is high, the internet is low, print is low, control, active processing, until context. Yeah, you can see this. And of course, we can compare this, yeah, whichever is more better, is better than for the company to use. Yeah, we just simply use it. And on figure 8.6 is a summary of the different characteristics of media. We can see the line here, yeah, the arrow here is recessive, intrusive. Intrusive means annoying. Recessive means it's not annoying people, so it's just a normal thing. Left side is more higher degree of information, whereas the right side is a higher degree of entertainment. Yeah, we can make this kind of mapping, and you can see the TV outdoor cinema is kind of like annoying and is more focused on entertainment. But for internet, yeah, this one, yeah, internet, yeah, it is very flexible. It can be annoying, it can be recessive. Yeah. So it's very dynamic. It depends on what kind of methods or what kind of campaigns that we are using. For instance, if we are using the pop-up banner, yeah, pop-up banner, when we access certain website and suddenly there's a pop-up windows appear, I think it's very annoying. Yeah. So that is intrusive. But if we are using a more subtle ways of advertising, like, yeah, just normal banner, very small, I think this is like recessive, yeah, compared to the pop-up banner. Yeah, these are the steps for planning integrated campaign. Yeah, I think I will not go through the details due to time. You can read from the book if you are interested, and also read from the slides. But I would like to emphasize that there are 5 steps for planning integrated campaign, and I need to reiterate that there is a very important keywords here, which is integrated. We cannot we don't do the independent campaign, but we have to do integrated campaign. Why? Because simply don't do like just one campaign or two campaigns. We normally do a lot of campaigns, and within each campaign, in each campaign in different medias, all of this must be integrated, yeah, so that there are consistencies, yeah, and also the results, yeah, can be measured more appropriately. So step one, goal setting and tracking for interactive marketing communication. Of course, the first thing before we start a campaign, we have to set our goal and how are we going to track the interactive marketing communication. Step two, we focus on the insights, yeah, whether the campaign is successful, how many reach, how many people who click the website or click the landing page, yeah, whatever the landing page is. It can be website, it can be Instagram page or whatever. Step three is the segmentation and targeting. We have to segment our market and target target appropriate market. For instance, if we target final project, right? You target the high school student, so you can set the age of the high school students between 16 to, yeah, for instance, yeah, between 16 to 19, yeah, you can set that on the campaign dashboard. Step four, offer. So what are you going to offer on the campaign? Yeah, whether launching new product, a discount, or promo, buy one get one, or what? What kind of offer that you include in the campaign? Yeah, and message development is, I think this is related with the copywriting. Good copywriting is also necessary, yeah, so that the customers can can be curious, yeah, can be if they read good copywriting, then they can be more, you know, yeah, they can be feel that, oh, this is a very interesting campaign, yeah, and also creative. I think people nowadays like creative things, like Graubünden, the Switzerland tourism advertising. I think this is that was very creative ways, yeah, to make other people interested. And the last one is the budgeting. This is also very one of the issues that the digital marketer need to tackle, which is the budgeting. Why? Because the budgeting, if we are talking about digital marketing, we cannot just use like very few money. I mean, the budget, yeah, we cannot just set it too small, but we have to have like, you know, appropriate number or at least relevant amount of budget, yeah, that we need to spend on the, about the budgeting. Yeah, if we set the budget too low, then I think it's not that useful if we're doing digital marketing. If we set budget too high, then it can be a problem with the company's financial. So that's why the digital marketers needs to carefully calculate, yeah, carefully calculate how much budget that they really need to do the campaign. If we put too much, then it can hurt the overall financial condition of the company. If we put the budget too low, then there is no use. Yeah, it's just a waste of money, yeah, to do campaign. So we have to really, the team of digital marketing team, they have to like, probably they have to benchmark to other companies. They have to maybe hire somebody who are expert in the budgeting for the digital marketing, so that the certain accurate numbers can be achieved, yeah, to make the digital marketing campaign more successful. And selecting the digital mix, yeah, digital mix is talking about the medias, yeah, when to use social medias, what kind of social medias that need to be used. For instance, for if we are targeting the high school students, maybe TikTok is a lot better, yeah, compared to Facebook. Because as as to my knowledge, Facebook is nowadays widely used by the adults more than the teenagers or the young adults. Yeah. So we need to take careful attention as well about where our target markets are located. Yeah, whether if it is in social media, whether they are still using Facebook. If they are not using Facebook anymore, or they are really rare using Facebook, then we have to use different medias. Yeah, and it's also very important, yeah, to select the most appropriate digital media, so that we just don't spend money and we don't have any good results, because the customers are not there. Because the customers, the target, our target is not there. They use other medias. That's why we need to do our homework, yeah, before we start doing campaign. At least we are doing survey, market research, small effort. Yeah, is okay, yeah, rather than nothing. All right. I think for the next part, you can read by yourself. Yeah, there are very interesting and also useful methods to deal with this digital media campaign. Yeah, who knows? You are you are trying to doing the digital campaign for your business. That you can use this as your reference for your reference. Okay. Yeah, I think that's enough for chapter 8. Yeah. In due to time, and also I believe I already convey the most important points on chapter 8, yeah, about the campaign planning for digital media. Yeah, is there any questions or anything that you want to ask before we finish our session, today's session? Yeah, please go ahead. No questions?
No, sir.
All right. Yeah, that's fine. Thank you, Michael and others. Yeah, the Stefano, Darin, Eugene, Gloria, Livina, Steven. Yeah. For next week, yeah, I will reiterate. I will repeat again. For next week, we will have a guest speaker. I already mentioned it on the first time. In the beginning of class. Yeah, Pa Harry. Yeah, he will share, or more appropriately, he will deliver the tutorials. Yeah, hands-on tutorials, with regard to how to design proper or good graphics. Yeah, and also a little bit tutorials on the video editing. Yeah, and I believe it can help you, it can assist you in doing or working on your final project. Yeah, so we'll see you next week, and yeah, take care, good evening, and yeah, bye bye.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Bye-bye.